Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us. This is Anthony Valeri, Director of Investment Management. Today I'm joined by Chris Considine, Director of Wealth Planning, and we will provide a market update, and then Chris will jump on and provide a financial planning update with the recently announced CARES Act. This presentation will be recorded, so you'll be able to view it in the future as well. Let us go ahead and get started here. Policy response to the coronavirus, and this is both from Congress and the Fed, has been very robust, and this should provide ongoing support for both the economy and financial markets. In fact, both the Fed and Congress have been stronger in their policy response than in 2008. They've also been quicker than in 2008. And again, key underlying support is being provided. The stock market has been incredibly resilient to an onslaught of bad economic news. More is on the way. It's increased nearly 20% from the March 23 low, as measured by the S&P 500. We'll get into details there. Much of the current rally being driven by optimism over controlling the virus, as well as a slowdown in new case growth. But I think the key really to sustaining this move is have Western economies broadly reopen. And there really isn't a plan or a detailed plan as yet how to make that happen. In the meantime, we believe we are still in a bottoming process. And yes, even this bounce in the stock market is part of that. Like 2011, 2015, 16, and 2018, we believe this difficult period will pass in time, could be a few weeks to a few months. In the meantime, we do recommend investors remain committed to a disciplined investment strategy. And then before I turn it over to Chris, I'll cover a few key points that I think all investors should keep in mind for the long term and hopefully provide some perspective on this environment, really frame the way you look at investing and financial markets. So let's get into the details, and I'll start first with the fiscal policy response. In terms of the stimulus, in the US, it's about 10% of GDP. And here this chart shows how big stimulus announced from a variety of countries is relative to their economy. The UK in excess of 16%. Again, the US response has been very robust. To put it in context, in 2009, the Obama administration put in stimulus that was 5.5% of GDP. And just yesterday, Japan announced stimulus that would be roughly 20% of GDP. So governments around the world are responding forcefully to help provide key support for their economies. We think that is needed. And while it won't offset or stop a recession, it can certainly cushion the blow. So governments around the world responding forcefully. And I had talked about the Fed. The Fed has also been incredibly strong in their response. They've done a number of things, from an emergency rate cut where they lowered rates 1%, and actually a total of 1.5 percentage points in March, to announcing bond purchases, as well as an alphabet soup of lending facilities to make sure that financial markets continue to function properly. One way to frame that is to view the amount or dollar amount of bond purchases for each round of QE or quantitative easing. The dark blue line shows the QE1 in 2008, once it was announced, and you can see that it started slowly and how that line moves gradually to the right. And you contrast that with this latest round of bond purchases, which is the orange line, QE4, and the dashed line. You can see the Fed has been very aggressive. They've essentially completed what was done in the aftermath of 2008 in a number of days. In fact, they are on track very closely, or very soon will have eclipsed $1 trillion in bond purchases in just a very short time, in just over 2 weeks. So in a very aggressive Fed, perhaps more so than Washington, the Fed has really done more than 2008. So very strong and needed response from the Fed. So policymakers have certainly done their job. In terms of the virus, case growth is slowing. That is a positive. The red line on this chart shows China, and you can see how the number of new cases has flattened out in China. They basically have very minimal new cases. South Korea is another country that has managed to flatten the curve, as the common terminology goes. And you can see globally, including the US and the dark blue line, you're starting to bend the curves here, and that's very important to stop that new case growth. However, just today in Wuhan, China, did reopen after 76 days of being on lockdown. And the key there was to really have almost zero case growth for 3 to 4 weeks before they reopen the economy. We're a long ways from that. Case growth has certainly slowed globally. It's in the mid-single digit growth rate. Only the UK is seeing growth in excess of 10%. So social distancing is working around the globe, but we still have to get that case growth down to almost zero to really be able to open up the economy again. So we still need a plan there, still need to make progress. It is encouraging to see a slowdown in case growth, but in the meantime, we don't have that plan to exit the social distancing restrictions. So that is needed. That optimism about the case growth is really pushing the stock market higher. It's been a key tailwind, as well as some of the actions from lawmakers and policymakers. You can see the bounce here in the equity market up again today, coming close to that blue line, which is a 50% retracement off the low. That is often a near-term target for these sort of bounces after a sharp, violent sell-off. Could go a little higher. I think the expected, at least my expectation, is about 2,800 to 2,900 as to where this rally might go before another period of consolidation ensues. But just as sharp and violent as the pullback was, and had priced in a lot of bad news, even some modest optimism can help the stock market bounce. So it's been a pretty good bounce. We don't think that this is a signal that the bear market is over. It's an encouraging sign. But again, this is sort of a typical reaction that you see after a sell-off. So hoping to provide some context there, would not be surprised to see additional consolidation or contraction even after this move. And let's just putting it into context that how this move is common. If you go back in history to all of the bear markets after World War II, and you can see them all here, they're kind of rare. The maximum decline is listed in the maximum drawdown column, and you can see on average that from peak to trough, the market is down 36%. The current episode, the maximum is 34%, so pretty much in line with the average decline. Some have been worse, some have been not quite as severe. The bounce back is about 19%, so very close to that 20% mark, and it's slightly above average. But you can see that on average, a 14% bounce up off the lows is very common during bear markets. So following the typical pattern so far, I think more is needed to show that the markets are ready to have more of a durable bottom in place. But encouraging signs. But again, this so far is normal behavior during a bear market. In terms of valuations, after yesterday's move, the PE ratio, which is the most common way to measure valuations, is in the just north of 15, about 15 and a half, as you can see on this chart here. The higher the PE ratio, the less attractive the valuations on stocks, and conversely, the lower it is, the more attractive. In late March, this PE ratio was down in the 13 range, not far off the lows witnessed in 2008 and 2011. So certainly a cheap valuation, but less so given this bounce. And it's hard to get overly excited about the current valuation, even though it is more attractive than history, as referenced by that gray horizontal line. But so it's another reason why we expect some additional consolidation. We just don't have the clarity on corporate profits or the potential extent of this downturn. So another reason why we think the market is due for some consolidation, and we still have, I think, more time before this pullback is ultimately over with. So that's where we stand on valuations. One encouraging sign, though, is if you look at valuations relative to bonds, they're about as good as they've ever been. And in the post-2008 world, it's important to measure the attractiveness of stocks relative to high-quality bonds. And the one way to do that is using what we call the Fed model, which looks at corporate profits divided by the index of divided by the equity index, say the S&P 500. And you get what's called an earnings yield, and then you compare that to the yield of the 10-year treasury. Now, the bigger that gap is, the more attractive stocks are, and vice versa. And you can see that the weakness in the stock market has made this Fed model put stocks at probably its most attractive level since 2008 and also 2011. So some of the most attractive valuations relative to bonds that we've seen in a long, long time. So if you're a long-term investor, Certainly, stocks look more attractive here, and I think that's helping in the recent bounce as well. So if you have a long-term view, I think this is a very important one to keep in mind. One thing that we do need to see more of in terms of having a putting a lasting low in place would be to see more risk-taking develop in the market. One way to measure that is consumer discretionary stocks versus the performance of consumer staples, which are more defensive in nature. A declining line means that the defensive sectors are outperforming. Conversely, if a rising line means that investors are going back into consumer discretionary stocks, which benefit from an expanding economy. And although we saw initial bounce back in mid-March, that faded and has begun to resume a couple of days here of consumer discretionary outperforming consumer staples. Would like to see this last a bit longer to give this market lift a little bit more in the way of legs to run. But again, need to see more risk-taking to put a lasting bottom in place. So it's starting, and you're also starting to see some improvement in high yields. And I think this is important because high yield bonds typically is bottom or firm out before the equity market does. And after the average yield spread eclipsed 10%, which was higher than the prior peak in 2016, but well below the 20% we saw in 2008, you're starting to see those yield spreads contract a little bit, which means a declining risk premium and higher high yield bond prices. So this is a start. It's encouraging, especially if you're using high yield as sort of an early indicator of improvement or more improvement coming to the stock market. But still value to be had, I think, longer term in high yield at current spread levels and some modest improvement in the high yield market. I want to would like to spend a little bit of time putting the performance of the first quarter in perspective. The decline in the Dow Jones in the first quarter was 23%. That's the worst in the post-World War II period era. You have to go back to the Depression era years and also 2003 to get similar comparable performance, and that's measured by the orange line here. And you'll see the decline in those quarters. The interesting note here is that not all of them are positive 1 year later, which is the darker blue line, but the average performance 1 year following the 10 worst quarters was 10.5%. So a pretty good number 1 year out after a tough quarter. So keep that in mind after what has been a very difficult first quarter for investors to bear through. And if you use the S&P 500, a little different story there in terms of the 10 worst. The first quarter of 2020 was the fifth worst all time. Here again, if you look at what does the market do 1 and 2 quarters past that, and then subsequently what is the gain 1 year after, and you can see that the data is pretty good overall. In fact, 2 quarters out, the average return in the S&P 500 is 16, just over 16%, and all of those instances are positive, including the post-2008 period, where stocks gained 1.8%. And if you go out to 1 year, all but one are positive with an average gain of 27%. So pretty good gain for the 1 year period. And I think that does bodes well for the future. And again, having a long-term view on the equity market. Now, one important point I'd like to convey is that stocks typically rebound before the end of a recession. And in dealing and talking to investors, I often the question is, when do I get involved and when do I go back out, get back in? These questions of timing are really kind of fruitless, and it's tough. It's important to know that stocks typically rebound before the end of a recession. These are all of the recessions in the post-World War II period. You'll see them all listed here. The average duration is 11 months. And on average, with the exception of one case, the stock market bottoms ahead of the end of recession. In fact, the average is that the stock market bottoms 4 months before the end of a recession. And it's important to note that by the time the recession ends, the stock market's usually well on its way to some fairly substantial gains. So on average, those gains have been 24.9%, so very substantial rally. So trying to wait till the end of the recession is really too late. And if this recession started, as we believe, in March of this year, if it is a shorter recession to getting the economy back online and it ends in September, 2 or 3 months in would put you at about a May or June timeframe in terms of bottoming. Could be later than that if the recession lasts longer. But again, this kind of corroborates what we expect to be a little bit longer of a recovery period or finding a bottom in the stock market. But do keep in mind that stocks do rebound before the end of a recession. I'm going to change tacks a little bit, talk about the election implications of the coronavirus. And since the coronavirus really took center stage in late February, it's had an impact on who's going to be in the White House. And this chart is from Predictit, which measures the probability of whether a Democratic or Republican candidate will be in the White House after the election. You can see the Republican Party had a substantial lead in late February that reversed to where Democrats were expected to take the White House. And in the last 2 weeks here, it's seesawed a bit. Right now, it's a bit of a dead heat as to who will be in the White House. But important to note that no incumbent president has been able to win the election after a recession. So no president has survived a recession. So it's an interesting one to watch as we head towards the election in the fall, where policy could become a renewed risk to the equity market in the fall. And interesting, it's also having an impact for the Democratic presidential nominee. Biden looks assured or very likely to get the candidacy here. However, his probability has come down off the peak, which was once nearly a 90% probability, is now just below 80. And Governor Cuomo has come in as sort of a dark horse. And although he is ineligible currently, it raises an interesting question. Has this probability declined over health concerns for Biden? Still highly likely that Biden wins the nomination, but it is something to watch going into the convention this summer. So some interesting developments on the political front. Now let me turn to a few charts here on just how to view the current pullback from a longer term perspective. First, I do mention PE ratios, but history shows that a PE ratio isn't a very good predictor of stock market performance over the coming year. And the chart on the left shows that. On the horizontal axis, you'll see the PE ratio. And as you move to the right, the higher the PE ratio, the more expensive stocks are, and vice versa. The closer you go to the left, the cheaper stocks are. And you can see those gray dots are fairly scattered. There is no particular pattern over what the PE ratio is and then the subsequent 1 year return. If you move to the chart on the right, however, those dots over a 5 year period do consolidate pretty close to that orange line. What that orange line tells you is that the cheaper or lower the PE ratio is, the higher projected 5 year annualized return. And vice versa, the more expensive stocks are, the higher the PE ratio, the lower your 5 year returns are expected to be. And at its PE ratio at the end of March, this past concluded quarter, that PE ratio is about 15.5. That corroborates with about an 8 to 9% forward return on the S&P 500. So valuations at the current levels or at the end of March suggested of much improved returns, certainly higher than about the 4 to 6% we expected this year. So the forward prospects for investors have certainly improved. And then another way to think about the current environment, and if it's just a real simplistic calculation, what is the implied return if the stock market gets back to its all-time high in February? And if it took 2 years, the implied rate of return would be 14.5%. If it takes 3 years, it would be 9.4%. And then as you go out 4 and 5 years, you can see how the return declines. If it took 5 years, showing a 5.6% total return there. Should note that after the end of 2008, it took 4.5 years to get back to the highs for the equity market. Don't expect that to be the case this time, just due to the fact that the virus impact will likely fade to probably in a year when we have a vaccine for good, but so a different type of impact than the systemic risk of 2008. So expect it to be a shorter recovery or a quicker recovery period. So probably won't take 5 years, but again, 2, 3, and even 4 year returns look pretty good from this perspective, especially when you consider the low returns that we expect from bonds. Speaking of which, bond expected performance after the dramatic decline in treasury yields is going to be much, much lower in the future. One way to forecast future performance in the bond market is to look at the yield of the 10-year treasury. And then the orange line here represents the total return of the Bloomberg Barclays Aggregate Bond Index, which is the widest measure of high-quality U.S. bonds. It tracks pretty closely that 10-year treasury yield. And again, these are 10-year annualized returns. So on a given year, returns will be higher or lower or deviate from the yield. But it does show the tight relationship between the yield and future return. And if we take the current 10-year treasury yield, which is 0.7%, it's basically forecasting around 1% or slightly lower total returns for the bond market over the next 10 years. So average return of just around 1%, which is really unattractive relative to stocks. And I think most investors wouldn't be pleased with that type of return. And again, some years will be better, some will be lower, but that's what we are tracking too. And then just two more charts here. One on staying invested and the impact of missing the best days. This table shows that if you started with $10,000 20 years ago and you stayed invested the entire time, you'd made triple your money. And that included some difficult periods at the start of the 2000s, 2008, and of course, various bouts of volatility in between. But if you missed even the five best days, the 10 days, you can see how that performance drops dramatically. And it's partly missing those best days, but it's also missing the compounding benefit of being in the market as well. So really important to stay invested. And if you miss more days you miss, you actually go in the negative territory. So important to realize that, yes, you do need to stay invested. It's just impossible to time the market. And one note on timing, just to show how resilient stocks are, let's assume you bought at the peak of a market, which would be very unlucky, and I think very rare, but just still to do walk through this example. This table shows all the instances of buying at a peak, how long it would have taken to recover, the max drawdown or decline during that period, and then what would be your returns 5 years and 10 years after having bought at the peak of the market. And if you look at the averages at the bottom there, the average return 5 years out was 4.1%. The median was a little higher. And then on 10 years, the average was 8%. So, for example, if you had bought at the peak of the market in October of 07, ahead of the financial crisis, and as bad as that was, investors still made 7.6% annualized over a 10-year horizon. So really not that bad at all, considering how severe that was. And there's only two negative returns over a 10-year horizon on this entire table. One was the Great Depression in 2029, and then 2000, which was post the dot-com bust. We did have September 11 after that. We also had the accounting scandals. And then, of course, the end period of that would have been 2010, which would have been still in the midst of, or just coming out of, the 2008 financial crisis. So, in general, important to keep in mind that even if you have bad timing, stocks still work in the long run and are resilient. So key points to keep in mind as an investor. I will stop there. Chris, I will turn it over to you for the financial planning side of things.
It's fantastic. Thank you, Anthony. That was some really good data, and hopefully everybody was able to understand exactly many of the, I think, subtle points that Anthony was presenting there. You know, I always try and explain to clients that, you know, the economy is not some big machine that gets expressed in statistics, because the economy at its most fundamental level is just you and me and everyone you know and Anthony and everyone he knows and all just going about the business of earning and saving and spending and investing. And those individual decisions aggregate up to this thing that we call the economy. And that's why economies are resilient, and that's why markets are resilient, because human beings are fundamentally resilient. It's just part of our human nature to be problem solvers, to be ingenious, and to overcome problems. And it's why the economy, with all the bumps along the way, tends toward growth over time. And markets are just a reflection of that real economy. Now, sure, there are times such as today where we have a big problem that's put right in front of us with the coronavirus and with social distancing, but I think we all have seen stories out there of people finding ways to still thrive. And you take That little bit of thriving, and you put it in conjunction with the fact that we're social beings and we start explaining, hey, look, I'm doing this, you're doing this. You wind up with a lot of people figuring out how to be able to tackle this problem. And, again, it's probably going to take us a little bit of time, but it's something that, we have a lot of confidence in that over the long period, our resilience as human beings is going to ultimately win the day. So my job today is to be talking about the CARES Act, which is the $2 trillion piece of legislation that went through back on March 27th. The president signed the Coronavirus Aid, Relief, and Economic Security Act on March 27th. And there's a few individual tax provisions that we want to make everyone aware of. The first one is the Individual Recovery Rebate and Credit. This is the one that's probably gotten the most attention, so you're probably familiar with it. This is the refundable credit. It allows a credit equal to the sum of $1,200 or $2,400 for eligible individuals filing a joint return, plus $500 for each qualifying child of the taxpayer. Now, this is something that they've been sending out currently. I know some people actually received direct deposit on this last week. So the government is doing its best to try and push that money out as quickly as possible. The second big one is there's no 10% additional tax for coronavirus-related retirement plan distributions. So individuals can withdraw as much as $100,000 from their retirement accounts in 2020 without being subject to a 10% penalty. This is a rule that's kind of always been out there in terms of the 10% penalty. You've been allowed to take from an IRA or from a 401k under some hardship provisions if you were under the age of 59 and a half. Now what they've done is they said, look, we're going to waive this 10% penalty, and they've increased it from $50,000 up to $100,000. Now, you are expected to repay this money, and you've got 3 years to be able to do that. So if you do repay it, then not only is the 10% penalty not there, but you're not going to have to pay the back taxes that would be owed on it. Also, important to note that if you are unable to pay back the full amount into that account, then tax will be owed, but it's going to be spread out over 3 years, which should make it a little bit easier to stomach. So finally, the other big one that we want to talk about right here is in regards to RMDs. In general, a retirement plan or IRA owner is required to take what are called required minimum distributions annually once the owner reaches the age of 72. This provision provides that RMD requirements are generally not going to apply for all of calendar year 2020. Now, the last little piece is that there have been some significant changes to charitable donation rules, which I'm going to discuss here in just a second. So let's go on to our next slide, which is really just our general guidance. In these challenging times, there's certain general recommendations that we believe can benefit all of us, regardless of financial goal or station in life. The first is to take advantage of the extension from filing your taxes. This wasn't a part of the CARES Act, but was something the Treasury came up with, I guess, about 3 weeks ago. Now, the CARES Act really demonstrates that the government is effective at modifying laws, but it's not very effective in getting actual dollars into Americans' hands. Hence, the extension of the filing date. This enables all of us to hold on to tax dollars for a few more months. Now, that you were not slated to get a refund. If you are slated to get a refund, then by all means file that tax return and get the refund in process. But if you are not expecting to get it, then you'll be able to hold on to that money, which we might recommend using to cover an emergency fund, which is the second of our recommendation for clients. The 3 to 6 month emergency fund is for moments such as this. And while it can be easy in the hustle and bustle of daily life to overextend ourselves, we'd recommend looking at your cash on hand in light of your current expenses, and hopefully it will give you confidence in your ability to ride out this storm and not sell at market lows to meet everyday living expenses. Another recommendation we would make to all clients is that they locate, review, and communicate their estate plans. If you do not have some ancillary documents, such as a durable power of attorney, a medical power of attorney, a living will, a directive to physicians, a HIPAA authorization, look to your state's websites, as many of these documents are statutory in nature and can simply be downloaded, signed, and witnessed. Also, we'd recommend you look at titling of bank accounts, insurance accounts, buy-sell agreements, and any non-probate assets you own. Changing title on a checking account might make sense to allow your spouse access to your main checking account if something should happen to you. Finally, now is the time to look at your investment accounts to see about rebalancing your portfolio. With market drops like this, certain asset classes could fall further or faster than others. And if you have an imbalance, now is the time to get back into balance. So we've put together this presentation really wrapped around goals. We want to talk the way we would talk to a normal client, which is we start with what is the goal that we're trying to achieve? And this deck takes the 12 most common goals that we hear from clients, and we provide strategies for attaining those goals given the financial, statutory, political, and epidemiological environment that we're in. Many clients borrowed money to finance their business and may have successfully borrowed money for themselves personally and now have a goal of looking to manage that debt. So for our business owners, there are a series of new programs available. The Small Business Association Paycheck Protection Program from the CARES Act is one of those. The Small Business Debt Relief Program is another, and also the Emergency Economic Injury Disaster Loan Program, which the last two came from the Families First Coronavirus Response Act, which is all of, I guess, 2.5 weeks old. Each of these pieces of legislation could provide small businesses the lifeline they need during this period of shelter in place. Also, just to point out that Zions Bancorp customers may request deferral on loan payments for up to 90 days, and I'm sure other banks may be offering something similar. For those with student loans, as of March 13th, you may request a suspension of payments for up to 60 days, which can be extended to 6 months if experiencing a change in income. The interest rate will be 0% for this interim period. And obviously, it goes without saying, we'd recommend looking at all debt at this point to see about refinancing the terms of that debt to a likely more favorable interest rate, keeping in mind that it will extend the terms of the loan. And also, in regards to the Small Business Acts that we were discussing up above, really recommend that you reach out to your tax professional to see if that would fit for your particular business. So let's move on to our second goal, which is the goal of making a major purchase. If your goal is to have a major purchase in the future, we'd recommend examining the two sides of the purchase equation. The first side is the purchase price side. So we'd say, let's see if we can get a valuation of this asset. Assets are simply things owned by people who may be more inclined to sell today than they were a couple of months ago. This inclination to sell affects prices, and understanding that price could help determine your course of action. The second side of the equation involves examining your source of funds for that purchase. Perhaps you need to rebalance these assets. Perhaps you'll need to reevaluate the time frame for this purchase. The delta between the funds you have and the purchase price may have changed during this time frame, and if that change is favorable, look to take advantage of it. Perhaps even understanding the financing options given the low rates likely to come from this current environment. Also, saving for a major purchase is a goal that is really less time-dependent and more price-dependent. So doing some homework here in combination with a solid foundation of funding and optimism for the future could result in achieving this goal sooner rather than later. So our next goal is saving for retirement. Now, arguably, this is the goal that we work the most with. And much like the saving for a large purchase goal, not all news is discouraging on this front. First, market conditions are such that if you missed out on the market run-up over the past 5 to 10 years, you can get in at equity values not seen in a decade with a very attractive price-to-earnings ratio, as Anthony just detailed for us. This opportunity allows savers to make up for lost time, and we'd encourage at least the continuation of retirement plan deferrals up to the company match, assuming your employer provides such a match. These matching dollars are free money, and failure to defer into the account relinquishes your ability to capture that free money. The IRS has also extended the timing of when you can contribute to an IRA. The new date for a 2019 IRA contribution has now been pushed back to July 15th of 2020. So you can make an IRA contribution for tax year 2019 and for tax year 2020 today at today's market prices, which we think will pay off assuming your retirement is more than 5 years away. If you're 50 years or older and you have the means to do so, you are allowed to make catch-up contributions to your qualified plans, again in an attempt to make up for lost time. And again, those contributions can be buying into a market at an attractive price. We do counsel courage for this next point, and that is to look at your employer-sponsored retirement plan, or really look at whichever account you have kind of earmarked to the side for your retirement. I know the value of it might frustrate you, but we want you to look at it for three main things. First, look to see if you need to rebalance this portfolio. If you don't know what the right balance is, reach out to a wealth advisor for help with this. Secondly, look to see how much company stock you have within these accounts. Some commentators have said that 20% of employees with employer-sponsored retirement accounts have single stock positions within their qualified accounts, and they don't even know about it. Diversification is really the only solve to market volatility, and too much company stock can make this experience even more volatile. Finally, if possible, now is the time to challenge yourself to increase your contributions to qualified accounts. It may seem counterintuitive, but the silver lining to the excess selling is that your retirement goal can get back on track if you have the discipline to ignore the noise and focus on the goal. Our next goal is supporting a cause. So many of our clients are charitably inclined, and in this time of great need by so many, the U.S. government is trying to better match up those who want to give with those who need assistance. The CARES Act has made several material changes to the charitable giving tax rules. First, for those who do not itemize, which is a significant number of taxpayers after the Tax Cuts and Jobs Act, taxpayers can now receive up to $300 in an above-the-line deduction from AGI for charitable contributions. All one is going to need are receipts submitted with one's tax return. Keep in mind, this will be for your 2020 tax return, not for 2019, which you'll be filing in July. For those who do itemize, the old rules only permitted deductions up to 60% of AGI. The CARE Act changes that to 100% of your adjusted gross income. Corporations are also being encouraged to give generously by raising the amount they can deduct from 10% to 25%. Now, which assets you give is another strategic change which we'd recommend reevaluating given COVID-19. Just 6 months ago, we were recommending you give low basis stock to charities and eliminate the large embedded capital gains. That is still a good recommendation. Unfortunately, many of our clients have less low basis stock as asset prices have decreased to levels closer to their bases. Also, there's less bang for the contribution dollar that charities receive, so we'd recommend giving cash gifts. Also, given the SECURE Act passed earlier this year, you might want to consider naming a charity as a beneficiary of your qualified plan. This might fulfill a client's charitable intent and reduce the tax hit that might come later due to the loss of the stretch IRA rules. Our next goal is managing employer and governmental benefits. If a client had a goal of managing employer and governmental benefits, say 6 months ago when they walked into my office, it really meant they wanted to maximize Social Security. And perhaps they had a special needs child that they wanted to know how best to manage governmental benefits for that child after the parents passed away. Today, there are lots of governmental benefits due to COVID-19, and the discussion has drastically shifted. As an employer, under the Families First Coronavirus Response Act, you could provide employees expanded family and medical leave benefits. The CARES Act followed the FFRA up and provides benefits for employer-provided educational assistance. And if you're an employee, you want to familiarize yourself with your employer's existing programs around short and long-term disability, as well as COBRA. As mentioned previously, unemployment benefits have been expanded both in benefit amounts and in those who qualify for those benefits. The CARES Act adds $600 per week to the state-sponsored unemployment insurance benefits and offers an extension of an additional 13 weeks of coverage. Finally, there's significant governmental relief from the CARES Act for small businesses in the form of loans or grants to those employers in need of assistance with payroll, rent, insurance, etc. Applications for the Paycheck Protection Program began Friday, April 3rd, for most small businesses, and for independent contractors and self-employed individuals this Friday, April 10th. If you are in need of help with this program, Zions Bank Corporation and all of its affiliates are offering help on that. So please reach out to your relationship manager. We'd like to be able to help you, be able to get some of these governmental benefits. The next goal is transition of business. Now, it might seem like a strange time to contemplate achieving this goal of transitioning a business, and you'd be right if the goal was to sell the business for top dollar to a third-party buyer. Valuations for all assets have taken a hit, and business valuations have no doubt followed suit. However, if the goal is to transition a business to the next generation of family members or to, say, key employees, now may be the ideal time. The challenge preventing many business succession plans has not been the transition of the management responsibilities. Rather, it's the tax and family dynamic issues inherent with such a large transition of value. If the business has lost value, then gifting or selling the business to the next generation becomes more feasible because it's just quite simply more affordable. So this is a good time to look at an owner's ability also to exit the business and live off of other assets. If all of his or her net worth is tied up in the business, then we will recommend building up that non-business liquidity to meet those retirement goals. This is a good time also to look closely at who can step in on the management side of the business. What skills do they have? What skills do they still need? Having a strong management team in place is important to the continuation of the company. Finally, now is a very good time to familiarize yourself with your buy-sell agreement so that you are knowledgeable about who has what rights and what obligations and which events trigger the agreement. A note for the post-COVID world, unfunded buy-sell agreements should be identified and funded, and we're happy to have those conversations with you, you know, as we exit this shelter-in-place world that we're in today. The next goal is planning for income and retirement. Now, if the goal is to plan for income and retirement versus simply planning for retirement, we'd recommend our tried and true friend, the budget. I know, a budget is about as enjoyable an activity as cleaning out your sock drawer, but in these days of shelter in place, we have an opportunity to really examine what is necessary versus what is more of a want. This lets you determine exactly how much you need annually and then where that income will come from. Perhaps it's Social Security, perhaps it's income from a part-time job, or perhaps it's a pension. Given the low interest rate environment, income can be a challenge, and that's where working with an advisor and knowing exactly how much you need can be of help. The CARES Act also helps with the RMD waiver for 2020. Keeping the money in a tax-deferred account for an extra year can help it grow as the market values start to bounce back. If you're not yet retired and concerned about income in retirement, consider a Roth conversion. This is a technique that we've advocated for a while now, but for very different reasons. The most recent reason being the SECURE Act passed in December of last year. But let's just do a quick recap. The key difference between a Roth and traditional IRAs lies in the timing of their tax advantages. With traditional IRAs, you deduct contributions now and pay taxes on withdrawals later. Presumably in retirement, when your adjusted gross income is lower and you're in a lower tax bracket than in years where you are still working. With Roth IRAs, you pay taxes on contributions now and get tax-free withdrawals later. The main reason investors have hesitated to do a Roth conversion has been the tax payable upon conversion, which is simply the spread between an asset's current value and what you paid for that asset. Given the market decline, this spread has narrowed, and thus so has the taxable gain. So let's go to the next goal, which is to support children, parents, or others. Now, supporting children, parents, or others is another goal that has probably moved up clients' priority lists, and we'd recommend starting first with yourself. Here we recommend establishing a mechanism for continued family support in the event of disability or premature death. Last week, we recommended getting your hands on wills, trusts, or ancillary documents. That recommendation still holds, but we would also add that you verify titling and beneficiary designations for all of your accounts. Also look at current sources of income to see what heirs or surviving spouses could receive from these sources if you passed away. If there's a shortfall, then speak with an advisor about insurance options to cover gaps that may be in existence. In terms of helping others, it's important to remember that you may give $15,000 to anyone in 2020 without having to file a gift tax return, nor having the payment use any of your lifetime exemption amount that you are allowed to give to others. Excluded from this $15,000 are any amounts paid directly to a medical care provider or to a qualifying educational institution. So if you have someone you'd like to help and can make payments to either their medical provider or their qualifying educational institution, you can still give them the $15,000 as well. Also, above and beyond these ways of helping someone, we each have $11,580,000 of gift tax and or estate tax exemption that you can give during life, but you will need to file a gift tax return for gifts that are above and beyond that $15,000. Finally, don't wait on gifting, as there are look-back provisions for deathbed gifts, which could invalidate gifts made too close to the date of death. Our next goal is defining our estate goals. If the goal is to define the estate goals, now is the perfect time to look at what you own, where it's currently slated to go upon your passing, and determine if this is still in accordance with your wishes. There is so much of this world that you can't control. Through the use of estate planning tools, you can take control of something that will bring you peace of mind. If you're still struggling with determining who should receive what and under what conditions, please reach out to your wealth management team. We're happy to help you work through this goal. If you already have an estate plan, review it, as your net worth might have changed and thus you might want to reevaluate who gets how much. Also look closely at your family situation. Are beneficiaries or fiduciaries still alive and still capable of serving? We've seen many documents naming now elderly parents or elderly in-laws as fiduciaries, and they may no longer be the best choice for fulfilling these important duties. Finally, given all the new tax laws we've had in the past, month, you have new opportunities for transferring more in wealth today than at any other time in history. So keep in mind the guidance from before. Now is the time to communicate the plan to family members, beneficiaries, and trustees to ensure all understand your intentions and verify fiduciaries' willingness to serve. Our next goal is planning for the unexpected. Some clients come into my office and say, I feel good about where I am today, but I'm concerned about those black swan events that could derail me financially. Well, to those clients, I say, today is the day. COVID-19 has shaken many of our beliefs about the future and our own mortality. Again, we'd recommend, just as before, to locate all of the estate documents. If you can't put your hands on some of those documents, again, you can download those from state websites. Also consider adding a spouse as a joint owner of perhaps your main individual bank account in case your surviving spouse needs access to cash in an emergency. Also, the probate process is likely to be slowed with excess demand of the probate system, so revocable trusts might offer a new advantage over wills in the upcoming post-COVID world. Besides preparing yourself and family from unexpected issues related to the virus, we would also recommend preparing yourself for an unexpected loss of income. As the past three unemployment reports demonstrated, there are a lot of people out of work. And while the hope is the CARES Act will stem the tide of these layoffs, we should prepare for the possibility. Again, a safety net of 3 to 6 months of expenses should be created or maintained, with the creation of this possibly coming from a CARES Act provision allowing for the expansion of legitimate distributions from a qualified plan. The Act, as we've discussed, now allows up to $100,000 of hardship distribution from an IRA or qualified plan, which includes a 401k. And this hardship distribution will be free of the usual 10% penalty for withdrawals before age 59 and a half, and it will be tax-free if the money is paid back within 3 years. If you can't pay it back within 3 years, the IRS will allow you to pay the taxes back over a 3-year period. Our last two goals. The first one is the funding of educational goals. If the goal is to fund educational goals, we'd recommend looking at these through a short-term and a long-term lens. In the short term, we'd recommend paying for educational expenses with cash instead of tapping into depressed educational savings plans. Let those accounts come back to parity before using. And speaking of those accounts, just as with your investment accounts, you want to look at them and make sure they're invested in alignment with your goals. Rebalance as necessary. From the long-term lens, now is a great time to establish or fund a 529 plan. If resources permit, even consider superfunding a 529 plan with up to 5 years of annual gift tax contributions in 1 year here in 2020 to a 529 plan. That means you can gift up to $75,000 into a 529 plan, which, depending upon the length of time the account will be invested, could fully fund most educational goals. So our last goal, and that's investing for the future. For those of us who've lived through several of these periods of market turmoil, we can only say we understand the anxiety and frustration that comes during these times. We understand them because, we're investors too, and we feel the same frustration and anxiety. But with this anxiety comes an energy and a desire to quote, do something. However, these are the times when focus pays off. Investments made in depressed markets yield outsized returns, but it takes courage to make those investments. And it takes courage combined with fortitude to stay in rocky markets such as these. But you've invested for tomorrow. You've invested not for tomorrow, but for your future self. And the best place to achieve inflation-beating, risk-adjusted returns is through a fully diversified portfolio invested over a long period of time. Being inside of a qualified plan or a 529 plan also doesn't hurt. So rebalance your portfolio if it's gotten too heavy in any given asset class. Ask an advisor for help in this process of rebalancing, but stay focused on the goal and the math that says the course you are taking is the right one. And we always encourage our clients, live in your dreams and not in your fears. With that, Anthony, I will turn it back over to you.
All right, Chris, thanks very much. And again, thank you all for joining our webinar today. We look forward to speaking to you again soon. We will continue our communications throughout this period of lots of regulatory and legislative change, as well as market volatility. So thank you again, and we'll be in contact with you again shortly. Thank you.